Greetings and welcome to another episode of Cannabis Storiez. My name is Shane Schlager, here to present a slice of cannabis culture every week. Today, coming from cloudy but very beautiful, relaxing Oklahoma, where I arrived yesterday and witnessed an absurd proliferation of cannabis dispensaries. This being a state where I didn't have the best history with authority and cannabis and various other attempts to obtain good cannabis. Things have changed drastically, and I'm looking forward to exploring that a little bit more in the next episode. Meanwhile, today's episode comes from back in California, where before I left, I sat down with Alex Todd of Saucey Farms. Alex is someone I've known for a long time in the poker world, and you can find Saucey products, cannabis products, all up and down California and in Oregon. And you might recognize Alex from being on Drink Champs podcast, from Forbes magazine, in his capacity as a celebrity jeweler, and promoting the product on MSNBC, various other places. Alex and I had a good discussion about the industry, about culture a little bit, and philosophy, poker, various other things. One quick production note is that we ran into equipment malfunction of sorts about halfway through the episode. So the first half will feature live interview footage of Alex and I, and the second half will be a collage of various other footage. So please enjoy my interview with Alex Todd of Saucey Farms.
Thanks for having me.
So tell us what's up, man. You are a legal weed producer.
Yeah.
How did that happen?
Very interesting. I was doing the jewelry thing. Pretty much reached the point where I was like kind of over jewelry and felt like I wanted to try something new. At the same time, obviously, you know, since I've met you, we've been smoking for quite some time. And, you know, like most other things, cannabis brings a lot of people together. And I just saw an opportunity just where there was a big portion of the culture, the cannabis culture, and people really that know about the industry, like me and you, that are like lifers and been smoking forever. And I felt like there was a big lack between people like me and you and the suits that were about to make billions of dollars in this industry. And I felt like there was a lot of money to be made. So I definitely wanted to try to get my footprint in there and also try to bring the culture aspect and try to bring some of the cooler things that I felt was missing in the cannabis space.
And I mean, and from there it was what, how did you get the license?
We started off in California trying to get a dispensary license. We bought a license. We ended up never opening the dispensary and flipping the license, because there was just a lot of loopholes and a lot of uncertainty in the store space at that time, in the dispensary space. There was no official rules. It was still like a Prop 215 time.
This was before
time.
Prop 64?
Yes, exactly. So, and we just decided to take a profit, and we took that money, and me and some of my friends, we went over to Oregon and decided to take our chances in Oregon, in a market there which was a little bit easier to get involved in. Licenses were a lot easier. They were given out more freely. And my little brother ended up getting a license, cultivation license. And, you know, from that point on, he built it out, a 10,000 square foot facility out there, cultivation. And from that point on, it's just been, you know, been ups and downs, and now finally got to a point where things are finally moving in the right direction.
In Oregon specifically, or in California
too?
Yeah,
Oregon specifically, you know. And then obviously once we started the Oregon project, took a lot of learning lessons, and we never had a brand at the time. We were just a cultivation, we were just a farm. Okay.
Saucey had not
even been launched, and we were just, you know, came to my mind, I was like, what would I do differently? And when I do California, what I think would be successful is to kind of just focus on building the brand aspect of it, and then worry about the cultivation and worry about the manufacturing side of it afterwards. So
at the present, there's no Saucey cultivation in California?
None right now at all.
So how do you guys, how do you source your products?
So we go out there and search for the best quality flower there is out in California. At that point, we, you know, do a bunch of R&D and, you know, our own metrics to determine what goes into our flower. And I'm usually the last, you know, I'm out there doing a lot of the taste testing. And then when I feel like it's up to par, that's what we put into our flower as of right now. Yeah. So I'm working with a lot of farms, a lot of, you know, people that, you know, we established relationships over the years with. It's a lot different than the model that we have in Oregon, but at the same time, it works for us.
Okay. And I mean, how do you ensure quality control from that? Like, what, like triple F and OG, right? Triple yeah.
So like, for example, the triple F and OG, it always comes from the same farm.
Okay.
The same producer is always doing it. We establish a relationship with them. Every time the triple FG is harvested, they come to us and we determine how much of that harvest we want to take at that time.
Okay.
So, you know, which has been a staple for us, you know, this triple FNOG has been with us since the inception. And there's a lot of strains that aren't, because we don't cultivate them. So a lot of these strains sometimes fade out.
So things do come and go.
They do come and go. And I think that's just like anything, and just like fashion and music. I think you need to stay up to par with what's happening and what the new hot shit is, and what people want to smoke.
So the people who are cultivating this also will cultivate for other...
Yes.
What are the different licenses? Like, what licenses are you required to have? What licenses is the grower required to have?
And there's multiple verticals and multiple licenses in California, and every state has its own different licenses. Like in California, there's a manufacturing license, which lets you basically make oils and put together joints and roll and fill carts. And then there's a distribution license, which lets you purchase, buy, and sell large quantities and distribute it, meaning you can drive it to and bring it to retail. Then you have the retail licenses. Then you have the cultivation licenses. Then you have micro licenses.
Now, what are you required to have of those?
As of right now, we have a distribution license, yep. And we have a manufacturing license in California that we could produce, pretty much do everything except for cultivate in those facilities.
Okay. So let's say someone out there wants to be the next Alex Todd and get a manufacturing license and a distribution license.
You could actually do it a lot easier. You don't even need to get a manufacturer or a distribution license. You just need to build your brand, build some awareness, and then come to maybe someone like myself that does have a manufacturing and a distribution, or some other people that might have a manufacturing and a distribution license in the industry, and ask for them to distribute your product. And you can work out some type of royalty agreement with them. And you can just basically get into the industry without having to make a major investment or have to really, you know, worry about licensing aspects and all the other expenses that come along with it.
But the person developing the brand, do they need, can you take a brand in that manner from the underground? Like, cause they have all kinds of brands now that are not,
of course,
with the California stamp on it.
Yeah, of course.
But I mean, are you suggesting that could be like that, someone behind that kind of brand could take it and parlay it into?
Absolutely. I think they should. I think that's the whole point, is like for them to take that underground brand and parlay it into something that they can scale and, you know, bring eventually worldwide, especially if they're doing it well on the underground level. Because if they're doing it well on the underground level, it really will translate, hopefully.
I mean, there are some brands.
We know of a lot of them. I'm not going to put them on blast here. But
I mean, they advertise themselves.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
There's meme weed. I mean, meme weed is like a big thing, especially back east. Yeah.
Because there's no other way. It all comes from those routes. That is back east. So it's like, what else could you do? There's no legal store in New York that you can walk into, right?
So that does make sense. I mean, I'm just trying to envision the path for some of those brands to then, like, get under the Saucey
umbrella.
It's
a gift and a curse, you know what I'm saying?
But even like, I mean, they would have to be partnering with someone with a cultivation license, right?
Well, not necessarily, but type of license. They would need to partner with some type of license. It could be a distribution license. And under that distribution license, you can have an office in their distribution license and just look for quality flower.
Okay.
And then buy it through their distribution license.
And then
distribute, have them brand it, market it, and have them distribute it.
So there is a DIY, there's a do-it-yourself.
Yeah, I mean, just like any, you know, most industries, there's ways of getting in for cheaper, and there's ways of getting into things for lesser amounts. And strategically, I was actually interesting. I was on Twitter earlier today. I was reading about Red Bull, how, you know, they're a 30 or 40 year old company, and they don't manufacture any of their, juice. They don't manufacture anything. They're just they white label the same way, and they're just a market, a marketing company.
So what you are describing is white label. It's a form. It's called white. It's,
yeah. I mean,
I guess actually, I'd be
on the flower side. It's 100% white label. Like, we're not growing the flower in California now. You know what I'm saying? It's 100% white label. But at the end of the day, it's a white label with integrity, meaning like we're out there totally doing 100% quality control, totally making sure it's something that I would personally want to smoke myself. And at that point, it makes it into our jar, which, honestly speaking, for me, if I have the choice, like, I don't want to deal with the cultivation. I don't want to deal with it. The only reason, like, I have to is because of the profitability aspect of it.
Right.
Where the money is made, you know what I'm saying?
Well, because, so that was a question I had, actually. Where is the, like, what's the best sector of the current market to be in? Like, if you could own a dispensary, or if you could own...
Listen, you got to find what you're good at. The best sector is probably selling all us idiots the soil and the pots pans and the lights.
It's
right?
Like in the gold rush,
exactly. Exactly. Levi's. It's hard, man. I mean, look, when we got into Oregon, my brother, when he started there, you know, pounds were going for like $500 a pound.
The price is cratered, right? Because they gave so many licenses.
They did at one point, right. And then they put a memorandum.
A moratorium. Moratorium.
Exactly. I only made it to the 10th grade. So,
is that right?
Yeah, that's right. Only made it to the 10th grade. But, you know, we put a moratorium. They put a moratorium on licenses, and the product became scarcer, obviously, supply demand. And just the whole market turned around after COVID, and now the prices have came back tremendously. I mean, now you can get upwards to $2,000 a pound in Oregon.
Oh, you can?
Yeah. And
so they trimmed away, like they disallowed some people?
No more licenses, just no more new licenses.
Okay.
I mean, if you have one, you have one. And then, you know, if you can make it work, make it work. And if no new ones. And so there was
a time when everyone was growing, right?
Yeah, I mean, not even that. It's just like over, like in the metric system, there was over 1 million pounds of excess marijuana in Oregon. Yeah. It was pretty hectic.
Yeah?
Yeah.
You take the over on 1 million?
I mean,
no,
yeah. I don't know if I take the over or the under. I know that they got lucky that they were somehow able to survive, most of these people.
Now that there's other states coming up for legalization, New York, Jersey, Florida, I mean, the whole Eastern Seaboard a big chunk of the Eastern Seaboard is coming up for legalization. Are you trying to get licenses in those markets? How do you, or what's the strategy, or what's the goal, or what are you?
So, like, right now, we're working with a couple of people to, you know, help us with our distribution in California as well. So we're going to partner up with someone here, hopefully in the next few weeks, announcing by the time this video comes out, might be already announced, might be made, might be not, but we're partnering up with some people. And, you know, we're also working on doing our own thing in these other states, but the people that we're partnering up are going to be multi-state operators, and they will have a reach in New York. So worst case scenario, if we don't have our own cultivation, our own licensing situation, we're definitely going to be working to make things happen for us in New York and New Jersey.
Almost in the same way that you described how someone could get in, you're going to be looking for different angles.
Right. So the most, like, for us, the most important thing is to have the best quality product,
right,
and hopefully get the time to market. So the fastest that we can get to the market with the most quality product is the route that we're going to go.
Are we talking about in New York and Jersey too?
Yeah. And New Jersey.
See, I'm already getting too. What are these pre-rolls that we're smoking? Because I see. First of all, last time I saw you, you got me stoned on these Capo pre-rolls. This is a partnership with Jim Jones from Diplomats. Yep. We'll get to the hip hop thing in a second. But last time you spoke me out with one of these, and I was dysfunctional. But this is getting me really high too. Actually, like
that's some of our OG. That's our four packs.
It's four grams?
4 grams.
All right, that's a good
in the package. All our flower is always indoor flower. We only use indoor cultivated flower. Even our smalls and our joints that we buy, that we use, everything is all top of the line. Like I said, quality control by me, picked by me. So it's like I wouldn't smoke it, I wouldn't put it in there. And then that goes all the way down from to the smalls to our, you know, our mini joints that we just put on the market. We're really excited about this. It's like a Corona special. It's a little bit difficult. You got to press the buttons in the back here.
Uh-huh.
And then these little Corona specials.
What are they called, Corona specials?
Well, you can smoke it yourself. You don't have to pass it.
Okay.
And then people can't really smoke a whole joint to themselves. So these are like little minis.
I heard them known as dog walkers.
Exactly. Dog walkers is a company.
So is this 0.3 or 0.5?
0.3.
0.3, all right. Yeah, this is like... after dinner joint, like when you sneak out, like instead of the cigarette.
Yeah, bro. These are great for like
sit there and
couple quick tokes if you don't got too much time, maybe at the airport.
So these are Saucey Shorties. Okay, so this is
all about an eighth.
The idea is to put an eighth in there.
In the pre-rolls.
What are these retail for, if you don't mind?
Yeah, of course.
it's not a secret.
They're about $50 for the four pack, and the minis are probably like $60, $65.
These Saucey Smalls, this is what, half an ounce or an ounce in here?
The one I gave you is an ounce.
This is an ounce, and this retails for
$120 to the store. So I think they're like $250 for an ounce.
Everything is so hard to open now.
Yeah, childproof.
I know. It requires like a a lot of elbow grease, or you have to like pass a Mensa test and figure out.
Yeah, I know, it's fucking
now, these are actually really beautiful nugs. This is like, so you said this goes for about $250 in stores,
in
right?
In stores, yeah.
This is where the value is. I mean, basically, the
100%, because what you're gonna do with the weed anyway, you're gonna break it up.
It all degrades, yeah.
At the end of the day, it doesn't look as beautiful, obviously.
I mean, see?
It's not the most manicured weed in the world, but okay, it's gonna do the same exact thing.
I feel like
you spend $65 on an eighth, or $60 on an eighth.
I feel like you're underselling it. I mean, there might be a little less THC in there because they're coming from like smaller parts of the bud.
Honestly speaking, I'm not even talking about the THC. It's just the I'm talking about the visual aspect of it might not be the most.
Sure, it doesn't have that big.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's not the prettiest girl in the room, but it does the job. It does the same thing.
she dances.
I'll buy, like, for if I'm going to dispensaries, that's probably what I'm buying, because honestly speaking, it's hard to spend $60 the way that I smoke on an eight.
Oh no, dude. So that was the thing.
Plus tax, plus this, plus that.
We talked about last week. We're in a celebratory zone here on Cannabis Storiez. We spent a gross amount of money the last week on research.
R&D.
We're definitely.
See, that's why with Saucey, everything is free. Shaniac loves it. The Jew in him, you know.
You didn't
have to spend on this.
I mean, that's pretty much it. I had to wait till I got here and got the kick down to really dive in. But before I was in the celebratory, like, to hell with it zone and buying $60, $70 eights, I mean, that shit is like
adds up quick.
90s prices.
Yeah.
I was pursuing these smalls, like a lot. Like,
yeah.
Well, first of all, I got to sell the weed. I mean, so. And it's just interesting to me, actually, the vanity will get people to pay like 2-3x.
Yeah.
Or in this case, even, yeah, I mean, what? So it's actually, it's.
And that's one of the problems also, where we're not cultivating in California. It's one of the downfalls and the kind
downsides.
Of downsides and like pisses me off a little bit is because of the price point that I can't offer to my clients and to our consumer. It's a little upsetting. Like in Oregon, we can really pretty much come in at any price we want.
Okay.
Because of the farming situation and our price point of what it costs us to cultivate compared to what we could sell it there for.
Right.
And we can be really price conscious with the consumer there.
Right.
And in Cali, unfortunately, besides for like the pre-rolls and some of like the, you know, value products that we put out,
right,
we can't really do that with like the top quality flower because we're not cultivating it.
So
it's coming to us really expensively priced. So we have to put it out a little bit higher priced, but it's one thing, you know, for sure, you're getting a hell of a product.
So are there cultivation plans in the works, or you are trying to avoid that whole territory?
I mean, I think that definitely, whether it's my cultivation or our people that will be running or making sure quality control will be, I think definitely cultivation will definitely be in the works for us for Cali in the next several months, you know?
And your goal is, I mean, either way, you would love to offer it at a better price point?
Yeah, of course. I'd like to get our price point down a little bit. I'll make it more affordable to the end user. You know, that's the end goal.
And just so people know, you have good distribution. I mean, like, you can find these products stores up and down California, and in Oregon, or is it?
Yeah, California and Oregon.
California and Oregon. I need to get to Oregon one of these days, but I've seen this in Bay Area, OC, San Diego.
Yeah, pretty much all of Cali. We're in about 100 dispensaries throughout the state. And hopefully with this new deal that we're going to sign, we're going to be going into about 300 to 500 of them by the end of the year.
Nice.
From what we hope, you know. So we'll be scaling pretty quickly here. And
are you enjoying it?
I love it. Yeah. I feel like I finally found something that I'm passionate about, that I love doing. And I'm excited about us being in like the kind of still the first and second inning of this business.
It's pretty amazing, right? It really
like,
is.
We really haven't even had federal. We don't have any federal legalization yet.
No, so that,
like, we're literally in the beginning stages of this business, right? So, how many other businesses besides for like that saw Bitcoin in front of our eyes, right? And like the internet and stuff like that.
That is the thing. I mean, right? And then there is this sort of like rush mentality. Like, you can get caught up in, I think, in a mentality. It's like, oh, we gotta get it done quick, get rich quick. It's like, you know, 3 years in, things are just starting to get dialed in. I feel like on the recreational market.
I mean, you
market.
See, even for our story, like, you were there when we first started. It was like 2 years ago. What was it, a year and a half ago?
Yep.
I don't know how long exactly
for
it
sure.
was. But yeah, around that time. And like, you see the progression, how long it actually takes to like get these things like to market and like develop them and get them out there and like fighting against people that have tons of money and
right.
tons of
no, I mean, there's basically like venture capital.
Yeah, everyone has hundreds of millions. Everyone that I'm competing against has at least a 20 to 50 plus million dollar bankroll from inception.
And I mean, that's really who's going to be guiding and steering the commerce. I mean, the level of commerce. And when we're talking about the underground labels, they're going to have to.
I mean, just like anything, there's going to be independence.
Right.
Like in the music industry, right?
There, and actually, I noticed that traveling around a bit. Like in SF, there are there's different
amounts.
Labels.
Yeah,
there's you know, and you can tell that they're well distributed up there, but they have smaller grows, presumably.
Absolutely, and they're really good quality.
Yeah, products. There's some good ones up there. SF
really
Cultivators
good.
Is really
good. Like I love the up north. I love the culture, the marijuana culture from up north.
Yeah,
you know, like,
and there is a brand called Up North that's really good. Yeah. But yeah, no, I mean that's the thing, right? Well, first of all, I mean, you're from Brooklyn. Yep. I'm from New York. I mean, I consider it a blessing that we're out here at all. Like, it's just crazy, actually.
Life is good.
Like, when we were growing up in Giuliani, New York, I mean, you could get taken to Central Booking for
a roach.
Yeah, absolutely.
And everyone
and
in the
did.
Car.
Did you ever get taken down
yes,
for
it? Yes, and like everyone in the car with
oh, yeah.
you goes with you to Central Booking because not one person will admit that it's their roach. So everyone goes to jail. It's a fucking joke. We spent 24 hours Central Booking. It's like, the only good part about it is that you had your friends with you. It's just amazing what a difference right now compared to what.
And then, right. I mean, but
we
even.
We have Gotham
yeah.
City right now.
Dude, even. So in New York now, I see people like in like Lincoln Center blasting music with their windows open, rolling a joint on their steering wheel. Like, cops in New York now, they don't care to begin with, but.
Yeah.
They're either on their phone or they don't care. And there's hardly any cops around.
I feel like it's like the old New York again. I don't know if you remember the peep show New York.
42nd
Street,
I do,
when it
know,
used to be
like
disgusting.
I grew up right there. I grew up in the 80s. But you're not old enough to appreciate how disgusting that is.
Right. I was born in 79. So I was like still a little
right,
young.
A little young to get this true sleaze.
Like, I remember like driving through Manhattan and it was like, you know, prostitutes on every corner. And it was just like...
We did a New York episode and I was talking about that. Dude, straight up on 58th and right near where you used to live, right where Petrushin is, the Russian restaurant.
Right, a few blocks up.
On 58th and 7th, there were streetwalkers out there.
Yeah.
Girls in fishnets. And yeah, man. Where in Brooklyn did you grow up?
I grew up in the Coney Island, Sheepshead Bay, Brighton Beach neighborhood.
Okay.
I don't know if you're familiar with it.
Like, that's the thing, right? Most cats from Manhattan aren't really. Like, I would get on the Q and go
That's the last stop on the Q.
I've taken the Q to the last stop many times, hung out at the beach, but I don't know if Sheepshead Bay, right?
Yeah, so it's like, I guess the two stops before Coney Island, Sheepshead Bay, it was like predominantly like a Jewish, Italian, Irish neighborhood, Sheepshead Bay was. I was born and raised in like across the street. I was born across the street from Lincoln High School.
Okay.
Which is like pretty much like Coney Island Ocean Parkway. That is where I was born. I lived there for a little while. Then when I came back to Brooklyn, I lived on Brighton Beach for a little while until I was like 14 or 15, which is like really Russian, but like mixed Russian Jewish.
And you're from a Russian.
Yeah, my parents are Russian.
Right.
My parents, you know, divorced family. My mom went back to Russia. I was living with my grandma on Brighton Beach. And
this is your own Brighton Beach memoirs.
Yeah, exactly. It was great, you know, just growing up, great, great neighborhood. And that's where like kind of going to school, I grew up, you know, in that neighborhood, a lot of hip hop and very melting pot community also, like right next to us, you know, obviously was fully integrated with any type of religion and walk of life. Obviously, you know, the way New York is
yeah.
like you have everything there. So it was amazing. It was cool. And it was just like,
you look back on your childhood fondly.
Yeah. I think I was great. It was just like different than what my kids have. It was tough. Don't get me wrong. It was tough. You know what I'm saying? Like, growing up the way that we did, and we didn't have like the financial stability.
Oh no.
No.
Okay.
Yeah, growing up I wasn't like that.
Yeah, gotcha.
So like later in life, my mom, like when I was already getting older, she started making money and stuff like that. But like growing up, it was tight. It was, you know, it was rough. Especially when I was living with my grandma and shit like that. But we always hustled and figured it out, you know, my family.
Is this you and Gene Todd primarily?
Yeah.
For those that don't know, Alex's older brother is like kind of an iconic poker player. I mean, partner in the business, but yeah. He's known in the poker world as Eugene Todd Bro, because he starts and ends every sentence with bro. Like, bro, so tell me, bro. since then you've also lived in Manhattan, you lived in Jersey, but now you're out here full time, right?
I'm out here full time for the last year about.
Okay.
Since Corona started, a little bit after that, we moved the family here. I've been back and forth for the last 3 or 4 years.
You were like commuting for a while.
Yeah, I was going back and forth.
Yeah, that's a hell of a commute.
Spending a couple of weeks here, back, which got annoying.
Yeah.
Moved the family here because they didn't think, obviously, legalization was going to happen there for quite some time. And now we'll see what happens, hopefully in the next couple of years. You know, I love it here. Don't get me wrong. Cali's beautiful and everything.
If you got to choose a coast.
If I have to choose a coast, I don't know. To live, honestly, I love the West Coast. Right now, the beauty of it, I'd love to have a couple more years here, at least.
Yeah.
But just business-wise right now, I wanna make sure Saucey is represented the right way on the East Coast. And maybe, I don't know where I'm going to live, like, to,
you don't
when
have
I sail
off
to the sunset, right?
There you go. You got to enjoy. So I'm going to get my Nardwar on here. I got a couple of gifts for you. These are some East Coast shit.
Nice.
Like, I know, because I've seen you listen to hip hop, that I think your favorite hip hop, some of it is Mobb Deep.
For sure.
Look at this.
That's dope. That's really dope.
You seen that before?
I've seen something like this, but I didn't know that there actually has from a farm.
So, I mean, it's Infamous Farms. I mean, I would like, you know, they don't exactly give you. The whole
this is
story.
Dope. Yeah, I can open this, right?
Please open it. That's for you to open. That's representation number one.
Thank you.
And now Saucey has a partnership also with the rapper Jim Jones.
That's right.
What is the nature of that? Or like what? How did that come about? And here, let me do that for you.
I think it was just like
this is an industry professional that cannot open it.
Exactly. This one's a tough one, especially.
This is a tough one. This has this texture.
That's a tough one.
I put in 10,000 hours of practice on this too. I don't think it.
That might be one of the
harder
ones.
No, it's a faulty bag.
It might be.
I'll work on this, but tell us about Jim Jones.
Yeah, so it just naturally happened. Me and my partner Juan from Rock Nation, OG Juan.
Rock Nation, that's the management side of Jay-Z's empire?
Pretty much. Yeah. They do a lot more than just management, but like, yeah, sports management, the record label, everything. But yeah, he's part of the Saucey company as well, and we were just sitting in his office and Jim walked in and we were just talking, discussing the space and thinking about who would be the best person like to have, you know, a piece of this and to do something with and like help with the promotional side and the marketing and the advertising and things in that nature, and just naturally fit. And we did a deal with him, did the Capo Blunt, gonna start putting out a bunch of other Capo products also right now, besides for the blunt, and just, you know, progressing to like a authentic friendship, authentic brand ambassador, also owner, you know.
That's all it's got. Yeah, so
it's more of a, you know, he turned in from having his own brand part of it into, you know, owning a piece of the whole company as well. So, you know, I'm happy to have him a part of this, and I'm hoping that we can chop up a lot of money together.
Right on. That looks pretty nice. I mean, so that was just something I saw on the shelf for a while, like I was like, damn, it's like, you know, it's a $65 OG. The guy said it was a good OG cut. What do you think? You're not feeling it immediately?
Yeah, it's cool. It's cool. I ain't gonna hate on anybody, that's for sure.
We laid out that principle on the show actually. Like
Definitely not hating on anybody. I love the packaging.
The packaging, yeah, it just gets you.
I mean, hard open, obviously, that first part. But in general, I'm saying the design and the look and the feel is pretty dope. And I love Mobb Deep also. So.
You love Mobb Deep. You know Mobb Deep well. This is another East Coast.
Well, I love their music. I don't know them.
You know their music well.
I know their music
well. I have seen you demonstrate a strong knowledge of their music.
I grew up on the East Coast, and I like the hip-hop, but just in general. It's like Nas, Mobb Deep, Nori, Jay, obviously.
Now, a couple of those guys you actually do know in person. You know,
lucky enough in later in my life to actually meet some of the people I grew up listening to, and you know, dissecting their music and doing business with them in the future, and now doing business with them and being able to speak to them on a daily basis, even some of them, is pretty cool, you know, and it's pretty interesting.
You've been a guest on Drink Champs.
Yep. Noriega, shout out Nori.
That was a lot of fun. Shout out to Nori.
Yeah, I think he has the best podcast and best interviewer right now out there.
It's actually incredible how good he's become. I mean, it was a good show from the get-go, but it seems like he's just like,
he's getting better,
he takes it seriously. Yeah, they get, sure. It's like really telling the story of hip-hop while getting drunk. And you contributed to that, you know, it's because part of the thing, you know, you're not a legend of hip-hop.
Definitely
you're Alex Todd.
Of course.
But it's pretty cool that you got on there. But it reminds me, I'm going to put this out there for the world. Like, here's my goal. And Shecky knows this. You know Jonathan Schechter.
Of course, yeah.
Founder of The Source Magazine. Like, one of the other, Benzino has been on the show, who's another founder of The Source Magazine. My goal, and I'm going to state it for 2021, I want to get Shecky on Drink Champs. I mean, Nori has said he wants to get him on. I feel like I have to motivate Shecky to do it. And my only upside is I want to be like the joint roller. I want to just like be in the room and rolling the joints for Shecky.
For sure. I haven't seen Shecky in years. How is he?
He's good. I mean, he's good, man. I'm hoping to see him in a little while. Like, he's got a wife and a kid now.
That's awesome, man. Shout out to John.
Yeah, shout out to Jonathan Schechter. And that actually, it's funny. You were talking about how cannabis brings people together. And it's like, why is it that poker players, basically there's such, like, I can't think of any like secular community where there's more like stoners than in poker. Like, now we're not talking about music or entertainment where you can basically be stoned all day and create. Poker players are theoretically sitting there, they have to make precise decisions and gamble. And we love weed.
Yeah, I mean, I think for a lot of poker players, it relaxes us and lets us be a little bit more patient, I think, than you would if you were maybe not medicated in the poker realm. And I think maybe helps us just with decision making and really tune in to, like, just like maybe like Adderall helps some people and enhances their in tuneness. And I think just with cannabis, I think with some people when they smoke, they really, it enhances their ability to create, and the same way maybe to think of and make decisions that you probably wouldn't if you were just on a regular head, just like microdosing shrooms. Like, I
really love that. Go ahead.
Yeah, just like microdosing shrooms. I mean, I've never done it, but from what I understand, it like just HDs everything for you and like motivates you a little bit more. And I mean, that's what I feel does like cannabis for me. Like, I can't go a day without smoking weed.
Right. I don't know yet how I feel about microdosing shrooms. I do definitely think I like the way you explained all that. For whatever combination of reasons, I like a high dosage of weed.
Yeah.
It works for my life. Yeah. I think there's also, I mean, I'm thinking about like the World Series of Poker. Like, poker players turn that parking lot into like a Grateful Dead parking lot practically. But like on breaks, it's just like there must be hundreds of people smoking
facts.
Individually.
Facts.
Facts. And I was just thinking, you know, it might probably also be just like that built up pressure of 2 hours of like gambling, trying to build chips, trying to win, you know, taking beats, all that. And it's like, what? It's like that. There's just nothing better.
That release, that stress release is, you know.
Yeah, we saw it in Vegas go from, you know, you could get kicked out of those casinos. You could get 86 for life. You could get
still
arrested.
Right.
I think they have to be. I mean, at the same time, I want to shout out, like, you know, Bellagio. Bellagio never kicked you out for smoking weed in your room.
Yeah, but you have problems like at the Win and Encore. Like,
do you?
I heard, yeah. I mean, not me personally, thank God, but I heard of people that had issues over there.
See, I mean,
Borgata, I know for sure people had. I know.
Well,
people.
Jersey, Borgata, dude. Yeah. Oh, Borgata, everyone has issues at Borgata. I've heard recent Borgata stories.
Yeah, yeah.
So, yeah, and I've had, I guess that could be its own episode, like casino smoking and the ins and outs of that. But, yo, let me show you.
You used to have a good podcast also about your stories.
Huh?
About other stories.
Oh, dope stories?
Yeah.
Thanks, man. I mean,
I used to listen to those.
This is kind of, you
that's
know.
That's dope too. What is that?
This is a reincarnation. So this is Dave East.
Oh, no.
You know the rapper?
Yeah, Harlem.
Harlem rapper.
Of course.
There's not that many rappers from Harlem. You can crack that
I
open
like
too.
Dave East.
These are both the OGs. So we got the, and then OG. That came, so this came from this came from Burners on Hate, the cookie store up in SF. That came from the new lemonade store. I think Steve Lobel promotes Dave East.
Yep. I saw the promos.
Yeah, yeah, all the promos. It was all over Instagram. It looked good. They were all about it.
Looks nice.
There was also a YGOG there, which I did not pick up.
Looks nice.
Yeah, it does look nice.
Mm-hmm, crystally.
We're going to have to crack some of that open after this show for sure. Yeah, that looks really nice.
Send that over, Dave East. Stop playing.
And I mean, what's funny is this, actually. This gets me started on his catalog. Like,
oh yeah, you never were a big
Dave East
guy, right?
I just don't know his music that well. I mean, there's so many artists, there's so many catalogs out there to explore.
I love the logo too.
I think it's very fly packaging. Yeah.
Good job.
It's a well done logo.
New Yorkers, they know how to do it.
New Yorkers got the job done.
Dave East got that swag.
But I mean, there you go. It's, you know, it's like a lot of rappers have affiliations with weed. Actually,
the reason why a lot of people started smoking weed is because they seen their favorite rappers smoking, right?
Well, look, and shout to Cypress Hill. Shecky, just to tie this all together, I mean, Shecky gave credit to Cypress Hill for really defining like that it was okay
to smoke.
Like, that prior to that in hip hop, it wasn't as common as we might think, you know?
100%. I mean, they were still like beating around the bush about it, like, you know, whatever, but at a certain point.
Yeah, no, but Cypress Hill just came with it. And I swear, when making my mind slow, that's why I don't fuck with the big 4-0. Like, Be Real, like, changed my life with that one line. Like, I felt like, oh, I didn't have to mess with the alcohol. Like, everyone else was getting stupid on alcohol. Like, you could just chill and like, and then you can create hype music like that. Crazy.
Amazing.
And speaking of hype music, I mean, Too Short was talking about his brand. And like, there's a couple rappers I can think of who have taken a very restrained approach. Like Redman's one of the top stoner rappers really ever.
Method Man, obviously.
But Redman said he was reluctant to get in the branded game from the get-go. Like, I don't know where he's at. I don't even think there's any Redman branded products.
I know I ran into him at the Hall of Flowers, like, I want to say like 2 years, a year and a half ago, right before COVID.
He was promoting
with Jim, and I know he was just starting, but yeah, he was getting into something and, you know, taking it, like you said, taking his time with it and just like not rushing and just making sure that it's probably, you know, the right situation for him. And
he said he went to Oaksterdam. He stated in an interview that he went to.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised. Like, he really wants to learn about the business and not come in here like, you know, like, not know what's going on. And I'm excited to see everyone in the industry, and there's so much money to be made in this industry that there's so much room for everyone. Unfortunately, a lot of these people that get into it, in terms of like, they're just lending their name to it and they're not like actually care. Like Redman, I can see like he really he wants to be part of the whole process and really cares about the end.
Yeah, he's
beginning
still,
to
I mean,
the
he
end.
Went to, literally went to school for it. You know?
So it's like, and then you have people, I'm not going to put their name out there, and then just lending their name to the brand.
Which, I mean, I understand the motivation.
You know what I'm saying?
That's,
of course,
it's a different
it's
thing.
It's a cash grab, and
Too,
God bless.
I mean, Too Short said something smart in an interview recently. He's like, rather than just like straight up promoting his product, he said, you know, the way it goes in this game to build a solid brand is you have to like put it out a couple times. You have to see, you know, like you can't just like splash it out there, put your name on it. So, and we'll see which of these brands fall. You know, it's like, it also depends a little bit on infrastructure and, you know, who you partner with, I think.
Of course.
Things can come together or fall apart.
Of course.
And I mean, dude, this is going to be tough to open, but go ahead.
And then again, it's like quality, right? It's like, how many times you went into the store, how many times out of the stuff that you bought, how much times are you now actually going to go back and buy that stuff?
Well, right.
Out of all these episodes, and again, we're not going to shit on anyone here, right?
No, no.
But like, you know, to yourself, think about it. How many times are you actually going to go back to the store and buy those things?
Well, that's kind of what the concept of the show is. Well, right. It depends. Like, I don't, so what percentage of the total weeds, of the total different varieties I've tried will I go back and buy? You know, right. 20%.
Exactly.
But that's actually just
for like testing purposes.
I'll
right?
tell you what, that's actually, that's not cause I'm, that sounds like worse than it is. Like, that's not cause everything is trash. It's cause there's so much good stuff.
There's a lot of good stuff, plus price point, plus this, whatever
plus
the reason
this,
is.
Plus flavor, like there's so many different flavors that I would say it's 20 to 30% of all the flavors. Right, on a cross section of quality.
But from a business perspective, right, I'm looking for a repeat customer.
Right, so, well, so.
So what's gonna make, I need to find products that are gonna make you wanna come back and buy more.
Well, so that must be challenging for you when there are limited growth, like when there's limited.
Well, that's why our SKUs, like our oils,
yes,
you know, are consistent all the time.
Right.
Our full spectrum oil, our pre-rolls, you know, most of the time are you know, keep the pre-rolls are consistent all the time. The only thing that's not always as consistent is the flower, but it's always getting better and better. It's not like it's like inconsistent, like it's always going to be good flower.
Right.
It's just the strains will be different.
And so that's just the process of dialing it in as you go. Is that something you're just trying to dial in always, or?
Yeah, I mean, I think that it's just the process of finding what people want to smoke at this time.
Right.
Which is changing all the time.
Well, yeah, I mean, unfortunately, I think we're stuck in a gelato rut.
It's been a lot of gelato. Couple of years it's been, you know,
a lot of gelato,
all gelato, everything is cold. Everything is everything gelato. That's not gelato
is gelato. That's the thing they got me on, like like four different eights of like things that were like cool labels, but like turns out to be gelato, and I don't love gelato, so I still fall into traps out here.
Well, anything purple now is probably gonna have that gelato-y taste to it.
Is that why?
Does
gelato come from purple, or purple come from?
It just looks purple.
Oh, gelato looks purple. My favorite right now is peanut butter breath. If you can source some saucy peanut butter breath, I'm on it.
Yeah, that's your thing.
Peanut butter breath is my thing this year. I mean, you know, my thing is Chem D, Sour Diesel.
Those are old school strains.
I'm old school. Headband.
Yeah.
And then right, so
like that Sour OG is like a pure headbanger.
Sour OG, I want that. That would be something I would exactly. You know. Yeah. So that's that. So, yes, and there's a few headbands on the market. There's Headbanger, or there's different brands out there doing different things. I know you've dabbled in some edible stuff.
We have a saucy lean.
Right. Did you have a version of that out here?
I don't have it in Cali yet. It's coming though. Right now,
it's only in Oregon.
It's only in Oregon.
Only in Oregon. Pro Dankazine, right?
Yeah, no, it's not called Prodankazine.
Okay, my bad.
It's called Saucey Sauce.
Saucey Sauce.
Yes.
Okay, but is Prodankazine the generic, or it's just
Prodankazine might be another company that does the same type of thing.
Right.
But what it comes from, it's basically a syrup. We call them a tincture because we can get them up to 1,000 milligrams of THC legally in one product.
And it's
a drink.
Do you mix it with Sprite or something?
You do.
Yeah. It's syrupy. Do you like it?
I love it.
I thought you last time we talked.
I hate edibles.
What?
I hate edibles. I love this stuff.
You hate edibles, but you love this stuff. Okay.
It's like nano, and it gets into your bloodstream right away, and you feel it right away. So you're not like kind of waiting for the edible to hit. You know, this should hit you. It's a great high.
Saucey Sauce.
Yeah.
This is
our thing. I'll make sure to get you something.
Yes, please do. We'll feature on the show. Maybe. Yeah. How long does it take to hit you?
How long? 5 minutes.
5 minutes?
5 to 7 minutes.
Oh, so I'm going to like sample it. If you get it to me, when you get it to me, I'm going to sample it on the show in a clear head. Like I'm going to not smoke that.
Perfect.
But the thing is, I have a feeling that'll fuck up my whole day.
No, I think you'll make your day great.
So it's just you got to plan your day in a certain way. See, I do edibles so rarely. Like, what's for better or worse, I haven't actually really covered any products besides flower on the show. I do edibles so rarely. Like, I took 80 milligrams of edibles on New Year's Eve, and I'm just like, I was catatonic.
Dead, right?
What?
Tired.
Just
right?
Like, it's almost like a, it's like,
I feel, I know what you mean.
It's like a hole, it's like a K hole, but
you feel like you're
like a C hole.
Kind of out of your body, but you're in your body.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Like paralyzed almost, you know, like a paralyzed high. Yeah.
I'm not a big fan of edibles, period, usually, but nowadays, little by little, I'm getting into them. This one I like a lot. I think it helped me out also with the edibles, like the regular edibles, because now I kind of know what to expect which milligrams.
I think that's a big thing, too. There's not a lot of great information about
just
correct dosing on edibles. 100%. Edibles are a tricky one.
What were you saying about that Gary Payne stuff?
Oh yeah, this is my last Nardwuar style gift to you. You're gonna have a hard time opening that.
Nah.
It's just another hard package. But have you seen those
2 gram pre rolls? No.
Oh, dude, that's a great product.
Yeah,
let me do it for you. There you go. All right, see, that's I just learned something. Dude, that is a great product.
All right.
Yeah. Okay. Let's see which one of these is the blunt. This is the blunt, right?
No, the Capo.
The Capo. But I thought this is not a joint pre-roll, this is a blunt?
That's a tea leaf. It's made out of tea leaf.
Okay.
But it's our blunt, yeah. It's what we consider our blunt.
Okay, gotcha. This is a gnarly looking thing. I'm not even gonna fuck with this yet. This is another thing that will get me basically catatonic. Like, I got too much to do today.
I like the way this is rolled.
Right?
Yes, very much so. I like the way it's rolled. I, for some reason, don't love the taste of,
you know,
I don't know if it's the hemp paper.
I do like that. It's got like a little sweetness.
Right?
It's got a little sweetness, yeah. I personally like it.
But hey, this roll is dope.
I know. You feel free to light it up if you want. I mean, it's a boss. It like makes you feel like a boss. And it's overflowing out of that package. You might have to give it a little like traditional fire, like a cigar. I mean, it just burns perfectly like a cigar. And you haven't played poker on a serious basis in a while, right?
No.
You play casually?
Yeah, once in a blue moon, if I get an inch.
We didn't even get to discuss the aspects of life where you're like the character from Uncut Gems, but in reverse. Like, I feel like you have all the same shit going on. You got the jewelry, you got...
sports gambling?
You got the gambling. You got the woman, you got whatever you want, but you're just, I've never seen you phased. I've never seen you, I'm trying to like your brother Gene can run a little hot. I'm trying to think if I've ever seen you aggravated or lose your temper or anything.
I mean, at a poker table, it's happened many times, especially at the World Series.
Maybe I have, I don't know.
I've been really unlucky at these, I feel like, at these World Series, and it's just like, after a little while, it's just like,
yo, but that,
it's so frustrating.
You gotta come
and
at
I'll
it
be
from,
like,
see, the, you gotta come at it from where the results don't matter. Where like,
right.
You just gotta take that saucy.
I usually get it in good, which is the important part, right?
I guess, yeah, of course.
I usually, you know, it doesn't. The map says I'm due for a big one though.
Well, then show. Are you gonna show up? They're running it this September, I think. Or
maybe. When is the main event then? October?
I forget the dates now. Actually, I think it's. That sounds right. I can't believe I'm too stoned to remember. They just announced it this past week.
My birthday is October.
All right.
If the main event is right around my birthday, then I might have to play the main event.
Dude, it could be a whole other thing this year. I mean, think about it. The weather is going to be different in October.
Which is amazing.
I mean, like, that could be part of the reason we're taking all these bad beats. It's like 112 degrees trying to fucking function out there. Everything's melting.
Only time I really spent one full World Series there was 1 year. Yeah. It was only 1 year. I don't, you know me. My brother usually.
But like
does.
Gene will be out there for every main event. I feel like. For
yeah,
the
Gene.
Rest of his
Gene
life.
For sure has been like for a while. Yeah. I mean, might have missed a couple in the last couple of years. But like, after having kids and getting married, it was just like, poker was just like really more. I wanted to turn it into like more of a passion thing I did for fun.
Yeah.
Than trying to make money doing it because it's just too frustrating for me.
So one funny memory I have is from you, me, and this legendary deceased poker player, rest in peace, Amir Vahidi. I think it might have been like a pot limit event. Is that possible? Like,
very
can you
possible.
Imagine? Like, what were? I don't know what either of us were doing playing a pot limit hold'em event. You know,
I love pot limit hold'em. I'm crazy.
They only ran a couple. Right. It was. It might have been also a table with like Alan Cunningham.
Might be the nit in me.
That could be it, man. Pot limit might be a better game. Could be the nit in you. You get it in too good. That's the problem. But I remember, your wife, Daniela, came by the table. And I was like, yo, Alex, your wife is beautiful. And you were like, thank you, dude. And like, no one in the world would argue that Daniela Spack Todd is not beautiful. But Amir Vahidi, like, almost like, who's Amir would sit at the table with a cigar like that. And he almost choked on his cigar. And was like, in my country, like you lose your head for that, like instantly, like you'd be dead. Like, so I don't know, that's a good example of poker, like bringing all, everything together. And it's all about the love at the end of the day. As we're getting close to closing up, you got any, the traditional closing quote for Cannabis Storiez? We'll give it to you to start.
Traditional closing quote?
If you can't come up with something, don't even worry about it.
Traditional clothes.
It could be a Jay-Z line. It could be anything.
Keep one eye open like CBS.
Where's that from?
My Jay-Z line.
Okay, there you go. Keep one eye open like CBS. I'll go with the Mobb Deep quote from Where You're From, featuring Eightball. And I can only remember the chorus where it goes, fuck where you're at, kid, it's where you're from. Because where we're from, you know they pack nothing but the big guns. And that's going to be a wrap. Yo, say it. Don't forget to
smash that like button.
Smash that like button.
Subscribe to my man Shaniacs. New thing on YouTube.
Alex Todd, thank you so much for coming out. Thank you for having me in your home. God bless. Thank God we're out here in California.
Good to see you, bro.
Smoking good. Yeah. Infamous in your area. Eightball in your area. About to cause mass hysteria. We about to do what? Yeah. Ashes to ashes, big gas to little.